and the Miami. And he always talk about PDE and the non-commutative motive and the homological mirror symmetry.
All right, so it's a real pleasure to be in Moscow, and thank you very much to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak at this conference. So the title doesn't seem to be related to the topic of the conferences, but at the end of the day, it is a bi-rational geometry talk. Just my approach is a little bit different than the classical one, but so hopefully we'll have a time to give a proof that three-dimensional cubic is not rational, but in a completely different way. So, the things that are involved are PDEs and little bit of rational geometry and a little bit of logic, and so these are subjects that I know very little about, but so the logic part I circumvented. So the PDE I cannot, but there will be a second talk on Saturday by Petkov, who is part of this project, and he will explain how the method of central manifold works in one example. So the idea of central manifold is that it belongs probably to, so I'm not an expert on this, but according to the experts, the first work on this was by Landau, who was working on the VS talks, and so he, in certain directions, reduced the PDE to equation, to ordinary differential equations, and in such a way was able to study some approximate solutions. And so later on, of course, this method was developed significantly, especially in applied mathematics. And used in many different things. But what we are going to try to do is basically use this method for geometry. And let me, before we go to some unusual things, look at things that we know a little bit better. So let's say that I consider a Riemann surface X. It could be an orbit curve as well. And I consider the modular spaces of representations of pi 1 of x into some reductive group G. And so this modular space here the structure of a stack, which over some open part is real analytic isomorphic to such a the modular space of Higgs bundles. And so these are pairs of a vector bundle and an endomorphism . So if you take a point on this modular space, so let's say rho, so you can consider the completion of the local ring of this point in this modular space. And now, using the fact that you have a C-star action on this modular space defined as follows. So you can put a mixed core structure in this completion, in fact, on the quotients of this local ring by the maximal ideals. So a different way to look at this mixed core structure is as follows. Yes. So a different way to look at this mixed core structure, which is kind of more algebraic, is to consider all extensions of this representation by nilpotent groups, and so this gives you a projective system of VIs, and you can take a projective limit. And so that is called a relative completion of pi 1 of x with respect to rho. And so this is a...
What is I?
So I is, you go over all nilpotent groups. So it's an extension of G with a nilpotent group. And so this gives you a projective system, and in fact, that produces a progroup, which corresponds to a certain Tanakian category. And so to this progroup, you associate an algebra, and then this algebra is enhanced with additional mixed core structure on it, which happened to be dual to the one that I described here. So in case rho is the trivial representation, this is the very well known rational homotopy type, the mixed core structure associated with the rational homotopy type introduced by Dillon, Griffiths, Morgan, and Sullivan a long time ago. And so just this is the trivial presentation. Here you only have nilpotent groups, and so you have the pronilpotent completion. The algebra associated with it, with each has this theorem mixed core structure. And this is just a generalization of it. And so, I mean, it's a heavy structure, but in fact, it does have a lot of applications. So the first one seems to be rather easy, but let's say that you could take an algebraic surface and so let's say that you have a vibration of curves, and so at some fiber you have two components or more, and so let's say that just for simplicity this fundamental group of this surface is contained in some GL and C for some very big N. In fact, you have to work very hard to find an example of groups which do not have this property. But assume also that the image of pi 1 of CI of C in pi 1 of S is trivial, then the fact that this thing has a mixed core structure implies that the image of pi 1 of CT, generic fiber, in the fundamental group of the whole surface is trivial as well. So that doesn't need to be true, and certainly it's not true if you're outside the algebraic situation, but the fact that you have this mixed core structure, which I describe here, actually give you this consequence, and So in particular, he has many ramifications. In particular, implies that if X is a smooth projective variety, such that pi 1 of X is contained in GLNC, then the universal coloring of X is homomorphically convex. So now, what we want to do is to try to create this mixed core structure in more general situation, try to build it in different situations, still very close to geometry, and then out of this get some application, some geometric applications, in some cases connected to a birational geometry. So the starting point of this is the following equation, which probably you'll hear more about on Saturday, so I'll be very brief here. But let's say that you have this bundle E. It's a homomorphic bundle on a Riemann surface. Yeah. And so what is true is that this homomorphic bundle can be given the following filtration. Parameterized by beta k, so where beta k belong to this group of iterated logs, and so if you restrict the Hermitian metric which you have on this homomorphic bundle on this Riemann surface, on Ek, so logarithm of this metric is behaving like bk plus of 1. And also what is true is that these quotient bundles all have slope mu k.
What is t?
B.
T. Log t. Log t.
H. 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 This is the
one line above. Log t.
Yeah, t is a formal parameter. And so have slope mu q, mu q, so and so the slope is defined as false. So thank you. So here, mu is the slope of E. So in other words, so I do split my bundle to pieces such that each of them is semi-stable of slope mu k, and then I have the parametrization of the other pieces given by these iterated logarithms. So now this is a theorem which was proven by Haydn. But it's a little bit different from what you know about the bundles on Riemann surfaces, because it tells you that, so there is an additional filtration to the Hardener-Riemann filtration, which comes with these iterated logs. And in fact, the way the theorem is proven is, and so you'll hear a little bit about this, is that you take the Young mu equation, it's like the norm is like this big case. So there is a certain norm which I didn't introduce here on this thing. Plus all of one. So I'll skip this for now. But the way this is proven is you have this Young mu equation, and so the way this behaves is that, so it certainly, you take the Young mu flow and it flows with exponential growth to some finite dimensional manifold. And this, over this finite dimensional manifold, so this PDE actually becomes an ODE, and so the asymptotics of this ODE are precisely this beta case. And so the behavior of this beta case, the behavior of the asymptotics of this ODE, tell you about a new filtration on this holomorphic bundle, which can be taught as an object in a derived category of coherent shifts on X. But in fact, it's an object of smaller category, a subcategory of this category of coherent shifts on X. And this category can be taught as the following. So let's say that I have my splitting of E. And so I defined a quiver category with objects being the vertices, namely these sub-bundles. And then the homes are the extensions between them. And then, so this subcategory is the nothing else but all object in the derived category of coherent shifts with fixed slope, or if you like, with fixed phase on the stability condition. So they do form a certain Artinian category. So talking about the subcategory, or talking about this ODE, happen to be the same thing. So in other words, so I reduce my PDE to ordinary differential equation, or if you like, I find some Artinian subcategory of the derived category of coherent shifts on my bundle, and so in such a way I get some additional filtration on my object. So in fact, this is not the only situation where this happens. So to the mirror of these holomorphic bundles, I can consider Lagrangians. So this is the Young-Mills equation. So this is the metric on H. And so this is the curvature. This is the, so the inverse operator of the, wedging with the carrier form. So a different equation where this is happening is the following. Let's say that I have a cylinder, and let's say an elliptic curve, two-dimensional toroid, and so I consider some Lagrangian or just a loop on it, and then so I apply the mean curvature equation. To this loop, and so the mean curvature flow flows my loop. So let's think about this as a cylinder to some extensions of Lagrangians, stable Lagrangians in my elliptic curve. And then, in fact, one can show that this is also equivalent to the reduction of the mean curvature equation to an ODE. And the slopes that I get here have something to do with the asymptotics of this ODE. And so that's worked out in a paper by Haydn, myself, Koncevich, and Pandit. And so the mean curvature equation leads to this new filtration on the Lagrangians associated with my elliptic curve. So in fact, using this, you can do the following thing. So define an algebra AL depending on this Lagrangian in the following way. So this is the sum, or k bigger than 0, from home of L to AK of L, where A is some hyperbolic element. Well, let's say for simplicity that's 2, 3, 5, 1. And so more or less you can actually prove that many of stable objects on this Foucault category with certain stability conditions are modulo over this algebra. In addition to that, you can use this flow to put a filtration on L and then a filtration on the whole algebra, which resembles very much the mixed Hausdorff structure that we had in the initial situation. And then, meaning this is the case of fundamental groups, their completions, and then you can draw quite a bit of properties from this functoriality and strictness behavior that this algebra also have. So this should be seen as some symplectic analog of this completion of the fundamental group. So let me, in a table, more or less summarize what we have found out. So we have a PDE. And so we have a flow. So this give us some algebra with filtration. Sorry, first category. And then an algebra with filtration. So the first example was this Young-Mills-Higgs. This was this Higgs bundle, so representations of the fundamental group. And so the flow, this is the Young-Mills-Higgs equation, and the flow is Young-Mills-Higgs flow. So which takes an arbitrary bundle, let's say semi-stable bundle, just for simplicity, and so flow this semi-stable bundle to a polystable bundle over some submanifold, finite dimensional. And so by this flow, this PDE is reduced to an ODE. And there's a category associated with it. And so this category actually in this case looks like that. It's just a quiver category with arrows going this way. And so of course, people that know a little bit of course theory recognize that this is nothing else but a different way to state the classical Clement-Schmidt theorem, which produces the weight filtration on the singular fiber. So the equation that you are reducing Young-Mills to here is just a num equation. And so the algebra is this mixed core structure on we have described here. So another PDE that we talked about is the mean curvature equation. And so the flow is the length reducing flow here. So the category is again the category between these Lagrangians, whatever it is. And then the corresponding algebra with filtration is this. So now to get closer to birational geometry, the next example that we want to consider, of course, this is the Keller-Ricci flow. And so now let me apply this to an example that people probably know very well. I mean, I certainly know very little about Keller-Einstein matrix. But let's start with some manifold which doesn't have one, like some toric variety. And so the toric varieties which do not have Keller-Einstein matrix or extremal matrix were studied by Donaldson and then by his student Gabor Shikiri-Hidi. And so what's happening is that, so I have this polytop and then that I associate with the toric variety, and then what's happening is that this polytop due to some destabilizing configurations degenerates to some new polytop, and each piece of this the generated polytope corresponds to a new toric variety, which in this case have a Kellen-Einstein metric. So in fact, there is a category here such that the vertices of this category are the corresponding toric toric degenerated varieties that we get. But in order to really define the Holms, that's really a hard job, so you need to use certain very advanced recent result by Luri and Tanaka, but you cannot do it directly on the your initial toric site. You need to move to the mirror. And of course, this suggests that, in fact, one can try to connect these flows with mirror symmetry.
Are you doing the Keller-Ripoff?
Hmm? Yeah, yeah, Keller-Ripoff.
Then you should get a solitaire.
Should get what?
You should get a solitaire.
Should get what?
Solitaire.
Yeah, yeah, and so that's the thing. Yeah, yeah, so that's, sorry. So this is for extremal. And so that's the, so what you get is several varieties. So let's see how this idea actually works with a mirror symmetry. So there are many levels in which you can apply it, but let me start with the first observation. It's the following theorem. So maybe before, it's the following theorem proven by Dimar. Myself, that minimal model, so let's say that X is a toric funnel. I mean, it's then minimal model program run on X corresponds to the degeneration of the Mirror-Landau-Ginzburg model. So, in other words, so moving with the Keller-Ritchie flow, correspond to some flow here, which degenerates Landau-Ginzburg model. So I'll demonstrate this on an example. So let's do some example in dimension two. And so that example will be P2 blown up in one point. I mean, yes, you will see that, yes. I mean, so I'll do very simple example, but I mean, you do get a drastic degeneration, if you want. So I won't be able to exhibit all the structure which I mentioned here in this example, but let me just some of the beginnings which already seem to be producing some variational geometry results. And So let's do the simplest example. So P1 blown up in one, P2 blown up in one point. And so, so the canonical class, so let me represent it like that. So it's H minus E, so the anti-canonical class. And so I use this parameter, so the Landau-Ginzburg model is the following potential depending on x1 and x2, which, so, and of course all these things have to be done over a Novikov ring, so t is the parameter of the Novikov ring, and so I have t in power x1. And so if you actually work out what is happening here, so the you can see that the Keller-Ricci flow on your initial manifold is the boundaries of the corresponding Keller cone corresponds to basically t in power minus t, where this is the time. So you are flowing this parameter, the parameter coming from the Novikov ring. And so on the level of Landau-Ginzburg model, what you have here is you have this critical values, which are all in a circle with radius 1. So this is again in the Novikov ring. And then, so going here and hitting the this Keller cone corresponds to the fact that one of these eigenvalues moves away and so reaches the boundary of this disk with radius 1 in the Novikov ring. So this time here is actually equal to this time here when you actually get out of this. And so here eventually you blow down your blown up divisor. And here what's happening is that so one of these eigenvalues goes away from this circle with radius 1, and so you are left with 3 eigenvalues inside here, so this is nothing else but the Landau-Ginzburg model of P2. So the Keller-Ricci flow on the symplectic manifold X corresponds to the this shift by minus, sorry, this this is not, no other way to say it, but I mean just squeezing, or if like extensions, or squeezing the corresponding radius in the Landau-Ginzburg model. So it's a very simple flow. It's just sort of extending or squeezing the radius of the place where your singular values live. And so it's easier to work with this one than this one. So let me just write this a statement. So basically it's a statement. So W x1 minus t x2 minus 2t. So the critical value of this are the critical values of wx1 x2 times t in power minus t. So this is the, so the Kelly-Ricci flow on your initial manifold is the flow of the eigenvalues of the critical values of this a polynomial. And of course, this could be explained by the quantum multiplication. So people in symplectic geometry know this well. So in fact, this maximal number for reaching the boundary of the Keller cone can be completely computed in terms of the eigenvalues of the multiplication by the canonical class in the corresponding symplectic manifold. But so now the mirror symmetry has two sides. One is critical values of this potential when you move t. So correspond to the critical value of this potential with x1 and x2, so you need to change this, times t, this is the parameter from the Novikov ring, in power minus t. And of course, that works in all cases. I mean, I'm just trying to work out a simple example. So the first case where this mean curvature flow, this Ricci curvature, Kelly-Ricci flow, is very simple. And so, now, but mirror symmetry has two parts. I mean, so the thing that I have described is, so the Kelly-Ricci flow on my symplectic manifold is connected in such a way with the eigenvalues in the matrix factorization. So Kelly-Ricci flow. So this is for Foucault category, or so the A psi on X. So correspond to this rescaling on Pando-Ginzburg models. And so, but I can take the Kelly-Ricci flow on the B side. In fact, that's what you do. And again, the corresponding flow is going to be rescaling the Flandau-Ginzburg model. And so pretty much everything that we have done with this central manifold and filtration can be done with these flows. And so there are many interesting things one can try to learn about group of variational transformation and so on and so on. But I mean, I'll concentrate only on one simple application here. And that is that, so you see, if you are studying the rescaling on the Landau-Ginzburg models considered on the B side, so all these categories are Calabi-Yau categories. And so the Calabi-Yau categories cannot have phantoms, and that's already brings you some rigidity. So now what you could do is basically work with, since the flow is the same, work with the flow on the both sides, and in such a way try to put some canonical splitting of your categories, namely splitting of your eigenvalues, or to put it differently, splitting of semi-orthogonal decomposition of your category that you have started with. And so the following, so this analysis that you involve here gives you the following rigidity statement, which certainly is not true for arbitrary categories, but in this particular case, for this one, seems to hold.
What is the
So I can do this as a Keller manifold. I can do this as a symplectic manifold. And so this is the, so I consider P2 as a symplectic manifold with the corresponding Fubini-Sturin metric, who need as a corresponding metric. And so, I mean, this probably can be actually defined for symplectic manifold, which is not Keller. But in this particular case, I mean, so they sort of are the same. Yeah, that's, in this particular case, it's not, it's the same. But yeah, what I'm saying is that most likely Keller-Ricci can be extended as some flow on things which are symplectic but not Keller. No, if X is Keller, they coincide. But so that's what the game is based on. But in most likely, what I'm saying is that there could be some analog of Keller-Ricci, which one can try to define on purely symplectic manifold. I mean, mirror symmetry suggests that it should exist. But in any case, this is not our case. We are dealing with simple Fano manifolds, and then our flow is the same. So, so they exist. A canonical semi-orthogonal decomposition on the category DBFX. So in fact, everyone needs to, I need to explain what these words mean here. So you take the symplectic form omega on the Landau-Ginzburg model of X, and so you take some neighborhood. And so over this neighborhood, you consider the quantum homologies of your variety X. And so this is an algebra which defines a spectrum. And so there is some discriminant here. And so pi 1 of this neighborhood minus the discriminant defines a groupoid. And so this groupoid acts on the flux either on the semi-orthogonal decompositions of your derived category or Foucault-Seidel category on the category of perf of X. And so this flux modulo the action of this groupoid give you a semi-orthogonal decomposition. And so what we claim is that modulo this action, there is a unique canonical semi-orthogonal decomposition that we can associate with our category.
What's the target of this map from speculation?
So it's so I mean so the way I think of this is so I have this neighborhood of my symplectic form, and so this is like a local system.
This is some subset of the issue.
Correct. So now, of course, so I'm just trying to keep this as close to symplectic geometry as possible, and everything is over C. But you could extend this over other fields, and then, of course, certain Chow groups have to appear here, but it gets a little bit more complicated. This is really things which is supposed to be working over all fields, and so in particular, you can indeed prove very easily with this calculation that certain two-dimensional cubics defined or not algebraically not closed field with very big Galois groups are not rational with this method. But so basically, this uniqueness of this decomposition considered together with this flow allow you to study this question when something can be blown down or when it cannot be. And so, so this complicated Carrier-Ricci flow that you have on X actually, as I said, is just this rescaling that you have with the Landau-Ginzburg model. And then, so the question comes when you can send this roots, so these singular values, to infinity, or if you like, to the boundary of this unit disk with radius 1. And so all this, basically, it's really determined by the monodromy. And in fact, criteria when this could be done or cannot be done were already started by Victor and myself a long time ago. So in particular, this theorem combined with these observations we have done with Victor is that this cannot be done because there is certain monodromy obstruction here which doesn't allow you to move these things in the case of three-dimensional cubic. And in fact, this is precisely equivalent to the fact that if you study the monodromy of the Landau-Ginzburg models for three-dimensional funnels, in several cases, the monodromy on H2 of the fiber happened to be not strictly quasi-unipotent, and so that is the obstruction of moving this to the this radius with length 1. So this obstruction allows you to prove, and so the observation that we have made with Victor with is that if you have these Picards with funnels with Picard 1, they are rational if and only if this monodromy around the zero fiber is strictly unipotent. And so this non-strictly unipotentness is precisely the condition when you cannot move these things to radius with length 1. So in such a way, with using very little from this big structure, which I have tried to underline here, you can prove the non-rationality of some three-dimensional funnels. As I said, although I didn't do this, this can be done over non-algebraically closed field as well, and there are immediate applications there as well. So, but this is just the tip of the iceberg. I mean, so we didn't use neither the central manifold, which in a way correspond to a minimal model program run within the minimal model program run, within the minimal model program run. So there is a deeper structure here, which I outlined, but didn't describe when it comes to mirror symmetry. But with more efforts and a lot of luck, I mean, hopefully this could lead to some other applications to birational geometry. So once again, I mean, the idea is based on the fact that the Carrier-Ricci flow, which determines the minimal model program into the classical situation via mirror symmetry becomes something relatively simple of this rescaling, and some monodromy abstractions can be seen to affect rationality or non-rationality, namely possibility to blow down or blow up, and so on. That's the what it is behind this thing that I've been trying to say here. So so there is more analysis to be studied here, but I haven't done this yet. I mean, since already dealing with these statements is requires some work. All right, I guess I'll stop here. So here, any smooth projective variety. So, I mean, if it's of general type.
But I guess sometimes this reveals a minifunctional composition if it's like a Calabi-Yau. Like.
No, but if it's of general type or Calabi-Yau, so basically this canonical semi-orthogonal decomposition, so if like the, all this. Singular values for the Landau-Ginzburg models in this particular case when it's are going to be at zero.
So
that's correct. Yeah. So that's exactly the point, because this. So if it's a surface of general type which has a phantom, so obviously it has the same orthogonal decomposition. But this canonical one is where everything is in one point. I mean, so that's the. Yeah, that's the, so the generical ones do not have this. But these things, because of some rigidity coming from analysis, does. So that's the.
What's the
mirror
of the general type of
so it's vibration over C with dimension two or. So if your variety is of dimension n, then the dimension of this vibration over C is m plus 2k. And then it has only one singular fiber with very complicated singularities in it. So this is, let's say, genus 2 curve. So the mirror is a vibration of some surfaces. I mean, this particular case of the Opetsu surfaces. And in the central fiber, you are going to have three rational surfaces intersecting in this configuration of rational curves. So in fact, you can forget about this big Landau-Ginzburg model and then just work with some category associated with these sausages. And this was what Sasha Efimov was talking about on, when was it, on Sunday here. So.
Mm-hmm.